Hello, everybody, and welcome. My name is Greg Geniscoli, and today we're going to talk about Tambourin Chinois by the great violinist Fritz Kreisler. Kreisler wrote this piece in 1910 for violin and piano. Since then, it's been reworked for violin and orchestra, and of course, George Hamilton Green arranged it for xylophone and piano. This piece is the all-state audition piece in New Jersey this year for mallet players. So I'm going to relate it to that a little bit, and then we'll do some more overall things about it. I'm going to play sections, and then I'll talk about it for you. So right now, I'm going to go to section one. Leading us right up from the beginning to the marcato section. First, about the mallets. I don't want to use what's considered a typical stock marimba mallet that I would use for solo pieces. When I play with piano, I use a combination of some vibraphone mallets, maybe some rubber mallets, and that's pretty much it. I think with the piano, that seems to work the best. This mallet that I use today is the Ed Smith mallet for vibes by Malletech. Of course, it's on a rattan handle, a nice thick rattan handle. And the thing that I like about a vibe mallet is the mushroom-shaped head. Some of them have that kind of a head where it literally comes to a real point, so it's a small point of impact when it hits the bar. It's a heavy mallet, so it gives me a nice big sound and a ring, but it also keeps some articulation because of that mushroom-shaped head. And that's as opposed to a round head or a disc-shaped head on a vibraphone mallet. These are good for today. A lot of times in recitals, I also, according to the hall, may use this one, the Mike Manieri mallet. It's just a step harder, but it's not much different. And then something for you to consider. If you're doing region auditions and all-state in New Jersey, Region 2, where I am, Central New Jersey, at the school, they always provide a kelon Musser marimba. And I did some experimenting with mallets on kelon this summer quite a bit with people listening. And the Dave Samuels 19 was the best mallet for that instrument. And it's again by Malletech, it's on a rattan handle, and it's a little harder than the other mallets that I had in my hand a second ago. And it really projects. It gives you a little more clarity that you need on the kelon instrument. So when I play recitals outside in the summertime, with the weather, I don't take anything but my kelon Musser, and for that, I do use these. I'm mic'd, and we still get a nice sound. They're kind of hard, but they work on a kelon instrument. Sometimes I'll try a Firth 154 when I'm practicing, but that high G sharp just doesn't cut through in a lot of situations. And the 155s are just too hard. So right now, as of today, I think I like the Ed Smith mallets the best for this. So one of the key motives that come up in this piece all the time, it's the triplet. It's right from the beginning. The piano comes in with the eighth notes, and then we have that triplet. This triplet has to have a distinct character to it. The accent in the music is at the beginning, and I think that means the intensity is there, and it goes away from that beginning note. Like that. It's definitely not this. So make sure that the intensity is at the beginning there, here, all places like that. We want to make sure that that triplet starts strong and then the intensity goes away from that starting point just a little. That's in contrast to the other place that the triplet comes up, and that's measure 31. This triplet leads us to the next note. So the intensity's at the end. That triplet's just a flourish, kind of an ornamental flourish that leads us to the downbeat after the triplet, to the next eighth note. All right, so make sure you interpret those properly and consistently. Even at the bottom here, we have, let me see, I'll give you a measure number. Leading into all these long rolls, at about 8 and 11, within there, so. That A should have a little bit of intensity, like a smaller version of what we had at the top, like that. Now I want to tell you, stick with the green edition. I learned this before I ever bought the green edition. I had the violin music, and so some of my things are a little bit different, some of my double stops, and of course, use the A flat and the C, and that would be in measure. Where is that? It's measure 22. I do a B flat and an A flat, because in the edition I learned from, it was a trill on the A, A flat. So make sure you do the C like Green interpreted it in his arrangement. You don't want to lose points because you changed some of the notes in there. All right, later, I like that trill much better, and I might even switch to performing it like that later if you play this with a pianist. All right, so one of the key things that I tell my students they must do in this piece is count. And in the lesson, they count out loud. They have to as they play. And this ensures that at home, they're working on that. Because some of these long notes that start on beat two, and then it's a quarter, and then a dotted quarter, they're going to miscount and lose points in an audition. So you don't want to have that happen. We have long G's, places like measure 8, and then in 11, have a B flat. They have to be the right length. That being said, each time I play them, I taper them down at the end so that I can lift, take a breath as if I'm singing, and then get to the next beat or the next notes. So I don't play static in very many places in this piece. There's one I always think of, and that's basically it. But here, so I taper it down and get out of the way with time to take a breath, but I don't lose my count. I don't lose my place with regarding the eighth notes. All right? So, one more is the A flat. Two and one and two. That also has to be counted and lift in time to get to the next note. I want it clear. I don't want it to ring or bleed over into the next notes. I want them to start clearly. That brings up another point. There's a run that leads up to that. There are lots of runs in this piece. Every one of them, when I get to them, when I'm practicing with a metronome, I go up and down, so many times to try and make sure that it happens for me when I need it to, in the performance, in the audition. Leads us up to an important spot. This E, I did a big crescendo up to this E, which is in actually measure 31, if you're following along. That E is very strong, but I'm going to need room to crescendo at the end of that phrase, in the green edition at the end of the line of music. So I hit the E, and then I'm going to back off so I have room to build again. All right, I just don't want to stay loud the whole time. I'll sound like a bad musician. I sound bad enough already. So, I lead up, let's see. I crescendo up to the G and then I'm gonna back off again. And this is another spot, when I get here, make good use of your time and repeat, repeat, repeat. And when you practice those runs up and down, do a little crescendo diminuendo. Get used to making music even out of the simplest little things like scales and runs like this. In Green's edition, that's down an octave. Take it down the octave like it says. I don't like it like that. I think it sounds dull, but you better do it. I'm gonna keep mine up high like I like to play it, so. One more time, I hit hard and then back off. Right here, and this I have to practice quite a bit. Repeat again. Sticking in there. I do all left lead, left, right, left, right, left, right. After this double here, B to F sharp, then it's all left hand lead with a crescendo and a slight accelerando. All right, make sure, just very slight. There's times where I get faster and slower and I use the word subliminal. I want the audience to like something and feel like it's moving here and there and exciting, but they don't even know why. It's just, I'm not really speeding up that much, just enough to give it a little more intensity. I used the word static a minute ago. This G sharp, as far as I'm concerned, is the high point of this whole section. And I get to it and stay strong when I get up there. Now this is a spot, like I said, where we change the tempo ever so slightly. I'm a little slower here now. After this, I slow down here just a little. And also throughout, I probably even still pull the tempo back more, you know? I exaggerated it a little bit, but I do pull back some, and then boom, I explode at the top with that next section, louder volume, faster tempo, and we're now back to that triplet. Two and one and two. And then on the way down, I definitely ritardando. The pianist is hardly playing on the way down with those 16th notes, which is starting in measure 51, and particularly in 53 and 54, I really start to put the tempo back so that by the time I'm in 54, the pianist has my marcato tempo, and when I get to the roll on the B flat, it's easy for them to just come right in and play the tempo I want for that section right there. And again, I'm gonna have to repeat this because it's just difficult. There's so many notes here to play, and I go back and forth slowly with the metronome, work it up with the metronome. Leave yourself a little room to diminuendo more when you get to that B flat roll. There are different notes in the two times that you do this. Here, it's a G, right? And then when you do it again, it's an F. Just like at the beginning, the first time, that's an F. The second time at the beginning, it's an E. Make sure you're meticulous with learning the right notes. Go back and double check all the time. Okay? So now I'm gonna go into the marcato section playing, and then I'll come back and talk about that. So that was the marcato section. And that section, technically in the music, it's labeled as the pickup to measure 57. I really think it starts at measure 55 in the piano part, because that's the marcato tempo that the pianist takes up. And this tambourin chinois, if we interpret it, it's interpreted as Chinese drum. And this section is the Chinese drum. Right there, and in the piano, two bars before that, where I start my B-flat roll. Now, just about the run that gets down to that B-flat roll, and also this applies to the end of the marcato section, which we get back to the a tempo. I practice these runs that change tempo and either take us faster or slower. They're leading us somewhere else to a new section. I practice them at many tempos, but in particular at the tempo I'm leaving and the tempo I'm going to. So when I practice the first section, I'll get to the B flat at the tempo that I'm playing section A. So right, I'll do that many times. Now I'm done that section, I'm gonna shake my hands out and maybe get a drink of water. I'm gonna come back and I'll practice my marcato section. So when I do that, if it's here, I don't just start there, I start here. Alright? So I've practiced that run at the fast tempo, and then at the slow tempo that I should end up right around in here somewhere before I get to the B flat. And believe me, I need all the help and all the practice I can get with those runs like that, because they're just difficult. Right? So, the marcato, once we're there, I want to fade this B-flat and let it clear before I get to the upper part of the instrument here. I don't want to connect those, and I also don't want to connect this. This has to be so clear, this Chinese drum part, and I do four strokes here. I don't try and tie it like that, because I might not make it in time to the fourth. So, four strokes, let the instrument sing, come off of it, so it rings, and it gives the illusion that it's connected like that. All right? Now, when I'm playing this, around measure 65, when we start to get into the accelerando back to the tempo, the double stops here that are close together, I'm playing marcato on the loud side, right? Right there, I drop down a little bit though. And what does that do? Musically, it's going to give me room to make a crescendo again, to where the most intense part of the double stops here comes in, and then I do my run and diminuendo down the run. And that's another run that I practice. Again, this whole spot, I practice at the marcato tempo, and then I practice it again at the fast a tempo. So I practice it marcato, I usually think should end up anywhere between 102, 112. So 112 is kind of fast, you know. And I even have some students that are younger play it at maybe 92. And then back to the fast tempo. The a tempo of this piece, the starting tempo, I usually think anywhere from 132 to 160, according to how well the player does with it, how long they've been playing it, you know, and what kind of hands they have to play fast. So you don't want to play too fast. 132 is fast enough. Don't go out and play this where everything's blurry. Make sure you can see everything that's going on. Then you know you're not going too fast and you know the piece. So anyway, my slow marcato tempo, and I'm going to diminuendo to that note. And then I would practice it at the fast tempo as well, so it gets me to this. And I think that helps me not get tangled up there, this little thing I do. And I play that as a little flam, and it helps my hands to get to the right place on time. And I think I like it better. It's less abrasive sounding when it's a little broken, then as opposed to this. I just don't like that that sound very much. Now, at the end of this run, I like to just touch that B flat, soft. You know, this is very intense up here. So I do a diminuendo in the music in Green's edition. It's got a roll. I would recommend to my students, so they're up here in time for this, 3 strokes to that roll. All right? Now, I'm going to go back and play the next section coming out of the marcato, and then we'll talk about that one. So I'll be right back. Measure 68 is where I think of the real tempo here. It's the run getting down to the low B flat. When you get to that B flat, which I just like to touch when I play it nice and soft, I think in Green's edition you better keep the roll because he wrote it in there. If you're doing Allstate in New Jersey this year, I just have my students do 3 strokes, which helps them to get up in time. One of those after the 16ths, right? So you make sure you only do 1 G the second time through, all right? And then you're gonna have to practice this. This gets big and strong and loud. I think you should put out quite a bit of sound here throughout all of this. The one spot that I really have to repeat. And then I hit that B flat. And it's almost like a forte piano effect because, again, I hit it strong and then I want to back off so I have room to crescendo and the slightest accelerando up to the top, up to the D. All right? I know in Green's edition, he has the third, so you make sure you play those notes. All right? And then we're going to, on the way down, a slight ritardando, and of course a diminuendo, which gives me a lot of room now to speed up and crescendo up to the top. I started slower than I normally would be, and I was trying to get back to my tempo to the top. And here, I want to stay up. I know Green does it a little lower on the instrument, those chords at the end. And I like that last chord broken. I just want it as nice and bright, not harsh. And I think if it was on the xylophone, that would be harsh. So maybe that's why he had it down the octave. And then my B flat. Nobody plays with you here on this B flat. So wait as long as you want to play that. Not too long, you don't want to bore the judges or anything. But you don't have to give it to the pianist or anything, you just play. Like that. In the violin performances, usually there's some kind of a slide. So I tried all kinds of things. I even tried this, which is nice. You know, but I like the chromatic run the best. I think it works from B flat all the way up to the D there. So I'm going to come back after the slow section. All right, so we'll have that played for you now, and then I'll be back to talk about it. lento section, measure 93. When you play this, still count. Even if you use a little rubato, I want you to count in four. Think of it as in 4/8, each eighth note would get a beat. All right, and I think this can be played anywhere from around 60, 66, probably I play it around 63 more than anything. All right, so I talked about for a second getting from the B-flat roll at the end of the previous section. So I do a little chromatic run. I slow down at the end and I really place that D because I want my pianist to be able to catch it. He doesn't miss it, but I like it like that. I like it fast in the middle and then it pulls back to a relaxation kind of a tempo at the downbeat, all right? Don't roll, I guess, because it's not in the music if you're doing all state or regions in New Jersey. I like the roll for me artistically in a concert. So, 3, 4, 1, 2. And this trill, is it in the music? No, but it should be. It's on the third beat, and I think if you listen to most of the violin versions by the great players, that trill's gotta be there. You know, it just really should be there. I don't know why it's not in Green's edition, but it's not. So it's each time in this figure, when we get to that C on the third beat of the bar, I would recommend it. All right, so. Pardon me, it's the fourth beat, isn't it? 2, 3, 1, 2. 1, 2. Make sure you count these long notes. You'll be heavily criticized with points if you don't count. If you're performing this, you must wait. The pianist plays on one and then you play the next note. So don't cut it short in your practice sessions. Now that note, I used to let it taper, the pianist would play, and then I'd go, I don't like that anymore, I keep the note going. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. I fade on 4, okay? Right there I fade on 4. I want to take a breath and sound like a singer. So it's got some space before the next phrase. And it also goes with what the pianist does. The next break I take, which is in the end of the G, is on the third beat. And that's because the pianist goes da 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 3 and finishes there. So we finish together. That's where I take that beat 3 where I stop. And even though we're counting and we're together, it still moves forward and back a little, and so we give the pianist always 1. All right, each time. Now this next section, the second real big section of this, this large phrase here, I pull the tempo back a little because I want to excel through it. 1, 2, 3, and 4, and 1, 2. 'Cause I'm right-handed and I know I'm gonna play that better with my right hand. So excel through that. You build the intensity through a slight accelerando. Again, subtle, slight, not a lot. And a little faster roll here and there, and also a little crescendo. A little, not a lot. This section is not that raucous. It's not out of hand with the volume. So this spot to practice. That spot's hard. That's why I do so many different things with it. And then, you know. Now, this spot right here, I'll play it softly and count it. One E and a two and a three and one. So it's one E and a two and a three and one. Like that. Right, right. That forces me not to do that too fast. And it forces me to lift and give it to my pianist also. Two, three, four. Now, I want to slow down there. I don't want to play fast up to the end of that. I like it fast in the middle. Just I like that better. And I want to give it to the pianist. And I want him to start on the fast side with the chords in ritardando throughout that bar. Now, I feel pretty comfortable here with this. Why? It's because forever I practice page 10, number 12, in George Hamilton Green's instruction course for xylophone. It's in G, but you should practice it in all keys. Quarter note equals 60. And I think as you go up in pitch, you should increase the volume a little, increase your roll speed a little, get used to building that intensity. Don't change the tempo and practice with a metronome, clicking eighth notes, but work on this. And I know he does left hand all the time leading, it seems like, when you go up in pitch lead with the right hand, down in pitch lead with the left hand. You know? Build as you go up in pitch, and then on the way down, at the end of the exercise, make sure that you do the opposite. Okay? So that's very helpful. And then we have the next section, right? When I come down, three, four. I end that one on three also. And where is that? That's at the end of the page, and it is measure 108. Now we're into the second large part of this middle section. It's on the of three, the way it's written. So I put it on the and of three because it goes by so fast that the audience doesn't even get a chance to register that it's there or absorb it or stop and think for a second, oh, it's so beautiful. So I want it to last a little longer. I play it on the and of three. One and two and three and four and a one. And this ornament should still be here. Even though it's not in the green edition. All right? Two, three, four, and one, and two, and three, and four, and one. And I'm still accelerating through this section again, just like I did the first time. And I know in places like, where would it be? Measure 118, the last 16th note, the and of four. I know it's not rolled. I always roll those, but you probably shouldn't. And one time it's on the end of three, that last time right there. And don't play this low D flat unless if you're auditioning for Allstate. And the same thing. People do many things there, and I think it's comes off as uncomfortable the way a lot of people have performed it. Not everybody, but so I give two little head nods. Really, it's a downbeat, and then I lift the sticks on two. One, two, and then we're in. we're just going. My pianist doesn't miss that. And that's pretty much the whole piece in a nutshell. Don't do this in the audition if you're in Jersey and you're a high school student. But if you're auditioning for college or if you're playing this in a recital, I'd play that with the last note on the piano instead of just standing there. I like to play that. It's just something, just a color at the end on the last note of the piece instead of not playing at all. So thank you for watching. And if you have any questions or anything, you just write me through YouTube and I'll make sure I get back to you. Take care.